This podcast is brought to you by LMU Munich.
Okay, so mic's working. So the last lecture of the conference, so I'll try to wrap up my lectures, and as you'll see, also make connections to many of the things that John and Sean also just discussed. So the common topic of our lectures was to talk about, at least this lecture and Sean and John's lecture, was to talk about metallic states. And the general idea is we start from some conformal field theory, presumably a strongly interacting conformal field theory, which is represented by ADS4. And then we apply a chemical potential and ask what happens. So right now what I'm doing is asking the same first question for free Dirac fermion. So that's, you know, always a sanity check with ADS-CFT. You know, what do free Dirac fermions do is the first question I found very useful to ask. So we're looking at free Dirac fermions, and you apply the chemical potential, and you get a Fermi surface. Okay. So what I went through some of this, so let me summarize the basic properties then of this metallic state you get just by applying a chemical potential to the simplest possible CFT of free Dirac fermions. So you get electrons occupying states inside a circle of radius kF, and the total number of states here must equal to the number of electrons, and so kF to the power d being the spatial dimension is the density of fermions. Then what are the excitations above the ground state? The excitations are you can create a hole just inside the Fermi surface, or a particle just above the Fermi surface. And the energy is just proportional to the distance from the Fermi surface. It's positive in both cases because we're talking about excited states. So the energy goes as mod Q. And we just, for future reference, write it in this strange way by saying Z is 1. So another way to think of it, it's like a 1D chiral fermion moving radially across the Fermi surface. And this will be true in any dimension. So many things about a Fermi liquid you can understand in terms of just thinking of it as a collection of one-dimensional chiral fermions. In particular, one of the things you can understand by that picture is the entropy density, which just goes as T, as does the entropy density of 1D chiral fermions. In this case, even the coefficient comes out right, if you properly write it up that way. And similarly, the entanglement entropy for a 1 plus 1D CFT, we learned from Tadashi's lectures, goes as log L, C over 6 log L, C over 3 log L. And that's basically the same result here. This log L becomes log P, where P is the perimeter of the entangling region. You get an additional factor of P from summing over the different directions. So that's, and in fact, that way you can also figure out the coefficient here by that method. Okay, so I'm going to fill in the second half here by talking about some more complicated metallic systems. So that hopefully I get that by the end of my lecture. But another property I want to talk about is the conductivity. So we already computed the conductivity for free Dirac fermions in my previous lecture. It just involves computing the current-current correlation function with this one-loop diagram. Now we just redo that computation adding a chemical potential. So this is the kind of more condensed matter notation, but you could do this with Dirac fermions too. Let's just do it at zero temperature. And after you do the frequency integral, this is the kind of integral you have to evaluate. But physically, we can try to guess as to what the answer would look like. What is sigma of omega for this system? So first of all, from everything Sean has told you, this is a system at finite density. So there's a non-zero overlap between P and J. Chi PJ is non-zero. And P is conserved. P dot equals zero. These are just free Dirac fermions. So therefore, the conductivity must have a delta function at zero frequency. Okay, so without any calculation, and in fact, with the benefit of Sean's formulae, we can also figure out the coefficient of the delta function. So omega, sigma of omega, it has a delta function, and if you remember from Sean's formulae, that was rho squared over E plus P, delta of omega, and if you just plug in the values of E and P for a free Fermi gas, you'll find that this formula gives you exactly the same answer. Okay. So that's one result we know from Sean's. What about at higher frequencies? Well, the frequencies are much larger than the chemical potential, really high frequencies. Then who cares if the chemical potential? It just looks like CFT. So that's the UV behavior. So in the UV, we know for a CFT, there's some constant, which is related to this Maxwell constant in ADS4. So that's what it should look like. So how do these things come together? What happens, say, just at small but non-zero frequencies? So another thing you can see by looking at this picture is that there must be what's called a gap, in the sense that conductivity is zero for a range of frequencies in this model. Because suppose I put in a, so at finite frequency, the way to think about conductivity is like optical absorption. You're sending in a wave, and you're doing Fermi's golden rule and asking if the system can absorb the energy omega, and the wave is at zero momentum. So a wave, light wave is coming in at zero momentum. It's going to take an electron from a filled state and try to move it up by energy omega. So what you see in this picture is that if you have some small energy omega, you can't do it. You take an electron from here, you give it this much energy, it tries to go there, well, that state is already full. So the smallest energy you can give and still get a transition is you have to have an energy over here, then you can go to an empty state. So at zero temperature, you're only going to get absorption above a certain frequency, which is 2 mu. So there's a gap of order 2 mu, and then there's a non-zero omega. And in fact, it actually, as if you for this case, it just turns out to be a step function. So that's the answer if you do it a little more carefully. And this was actually done in this paper by Ando et al. And this is their result. Well, they actually put in finite temperature, disorder, all of this fancy stuff. But if you just look at the zero temperature, zero disorder limit, it's exactly what I drew here. All right. So let's keep that in mind because we're going to compare that to holography. All right. So that's then the conclusion of my discussion of what happens when you take the most trivial CFT and add a chemical potential. So now let's take the most trivial CFT from holography and do the same thing and see what we get. Before I go there, here's the experiment. So the experiment's actually, this whole function works beautifully. You get exactly, so I previously only commented on this high frequency behavior, but in experiments you do see the gap and then this due to peak at low frequency. And this gradual behavior is probably due to disorder, partly due to temperature. Actually, no, at these frequencies, it's just disorder. Anyway, so I think it just agrees extremely well with these calculations. Okay, so that's as far as the experiments, these current experiments are concerned, that's pretty much the whole story. All right, so now let's talk about holography. So this is a point that many lecturers have already mentioned. When you start with the CFT and you add a chemical potential, in the very simplest theory, you get what's called the Reisner-Nordström solution. So let's look at some of its properties. What we're doing again, begin with the CFT. But for us now, a CFT is not free Dirac fermions. A CFT is Einstein gravity in four dimensions. And then we add a chemical potential, that's the solution that we know. We add a chemical potential. And in Einstein gravity, that corresponds to putting a boundary condition on the gauge field that must equal mu at the boundary. Okay. So now you resolve the Einstein-Maxwell's equations with this new boundary conditions, as many lecturers have already indicated. What you get is what's called the ADS Reisner-Nordström solution. Have I written down? So that's explicitly what it is, with all the factors of 3 and 2. And its basic feature is you have a horizon here, which is present actually even at zero temperature, unlike the conformal field theory case. And there's an electric flux, which you think of as being sourced by the charge density on the boundary theory, and it goes right into the horizon. And as Sean discussed, if you want to compute the low energy properties of this type of state, you can look at the near-horizon behavior of fluctuations of the Einstein-Maxwell theory. That's an ADS2 cross R2 metric. Again, a fact mentioned by many people. Okay, so for example, one of the calculations that Sean did was to compute the frequency-dependent conductivity. So this is, again, exactly this result here. And you see that, well, it has some similarities, certainly, as you lower the temperature. It's constant at high frequency. That's good. It doesn't have a very sharp threshold. It comes in gradually. And it comes in with some power law. And this power law is what is the kind of thing that you can compute by looking at the near horizon physics in the way that Sean was just discussing. So that power law clearly is not present in the free CFD. It's a consequence of this horizon that's present in ADS2, even at zero temperature. And also another feature, which wasn't in this plot, is this delta function at zero frequency, which is certainly is present when you do that whole thing honestly in using the ADS CFD rules. All right, so the conclusion is, well, okay, that sort of looks like graphene, but here the gradual decay is not due to interactions, it's almost surely due to disorder. But this is at some level quite encouraging. The answer from ADS-CFT is not crazy. It's got many of the basic features, but if you look very closely at some of the details, they don't quite work as far as the conductivity is concerned. Okay? But there are some other features that are somewhat more bothersome to me, at least, that we have to think about a bit more. One which Sean also mentioned, it has a non-zero entropy at zero temperature. This is again associated with the fact that the horizon survives at zero temperature. But somewhat more concerned to me is this fact that this Luttinger theorem is not satisfied. So the Luttinger theorem tells us that if you look at the Green's function of an electron, it should display a Fermi surface where the energy of the electron goes to zero in a circle of radius kF. Now you can add electrons to this theory and look at their probe Green's function, and that's what these three papers here did early on in this ADS-CMT field. And what they showed was you do get a Fermi surface, so that's exciting, but its volume, its area is completely wrong. It's not equal to the charge density, it does not obey the Luttinger volume. So in fact, most of the density is not in the Fermi surface. So it's really badly violated by a factor of n squared. And really the question I want to turn to in the rest of my lecture is where did the fermions go, or where did the density go? It's not inside any Fermi surface you can try to measure by measuring an electron Green's function. It's behind the horizon. So what we need to know is what lies behind the horizon. That's really the difficult question we are facing here. Has a flavor of the firewall argument that's going on in ADS-CFT these days. Okay, but here we're in equilibrium, things life is a little simpler, but we had finite density, and that makes it a little more complicated. Okay, so what I'm going to do next is part C, as I keep switching back and forth, I'm going to go to put on my condensed matter hat and talk about, well, what do we know, what other states are possible, which are compressible. As I said in my last lecture, compressible states either break a symmetry, in which case we're not so interested in them because then the low energy excitations are somewhat intimately tied just to the symmetry breaking. And we understand symmetry breaking. Or they have Fermi surfaces. And I've just talked about the very simplest state with the Fermi surface, which is just an weakly interacting electron gas. But are there any other examples of compressible states which are not Landau Fermi liquids but do have, which are compressible? And as we'll find, in condensed matter, such states also have Fermi surfaces, but rather strange Fermi surfaces. So this is a topic of much research in the condensed matter community in the last 20 years, I would say. And I think we're all now a consensus emerging from many different directions, including numerical studies, that there are actually some new types of compressible states. And I'm going to try to explain what they are. As you'll see, they turn out to be very closely tied to gauge theories. So that's good news for ADS-CFT because that's what ADS-CFT is designed for. Okay, so let me just give you some introduction to non-Fermi liquids from a condensed matter perspective. Okay, I go back to the very beginning of my lectures where I talked about, so what I'm actually going to talk about is not electrons at all, I'm going to talk about bosons. And I'm going to ask the question, can a system of bosons be compressible without breaking symmetry? And curiously, that turns out to be an easier question than for fermions. With fermions, the answer is yes, and the most obvious answer is almost always the right one, which is a Fermi liquid. But for bosons, you know, there is no obvious answer. So anything you find that's compressible that doesn't break a symmetry, it's got to be interesting. So that's why we think about bosons first. So take a bunch of bosons and put in some contact interactions and make them hop on a lattice. And as I already discussed, you can certainly get a superfluid or an insulator. This is an incompressible phase. This is a compressible phase and break symmetry. So we're not interested at this point. So can bosons form a compressible phase without breaking a symmetry? So this is a sort of question that actually many people in the spin liquid field have asked, especially Matthew Fisher has worked on this. And I'll give you the current status of that understanding. All right, so that's a CFT, anyway. All right, so what I'm going to do is at least as a thought experiment, add some other coupling other than just the nearest neighbor interaction. So the kind of coupling that seems to work in numerical studies is what we call a ring exchange. So imagine there's a ring exchange term with a coefficient W. And this has the feature that it moves, exactly as the name says, moves bosons around a ring. So in particular, let's see if I got this right. Let's take this boson and that boson. If I hit this term on it, this boson will move there and this one will move there. So that's like a ring exchange. And if you act again, they come back to where they are. Of course, my terminology wasn't completely correct. I should say that these two bosons move from here, to there. I can't say which one went where. There's two bosons here in one term, and there's two bosons there. Or you can think of it either this way or this way. It's the same thing, of course, because the bosons are identical. So that's a ring exchange term, a boson. So this boson, according to this this term, or this boson here, can only move if there's a boson here. If it's just by itself, it can only move by the T term. So this is the kind of term that allows boson to move only if they see a partner. So boson by itself can't move, but if it sees a partner, it can move together. So that's the kind of term you add. And that's introducing correlations in a non-trivial way. And of course, if W is small, it doesn't do very much, but in numerical experiments, you crank up W and make it even bigger than T, but not infinitely large. And then you ask, what do you get? Can you get a compressible state? Can you get some other ground state, which is not the most obvious state, which is a superfluid at some generic density? Okay, I mean, this is sort of a question that's been in condensed matter physics for several decades. Can bosons at generic density avoid being a superfluid? And people have had all kinds of opinions of it over the years, but I think now there's a consensus that they can. And the kind of thing they form is, let me skip that, is the following. It's a non-Fermi liquid, which you will call a Bose metal. And the way you think about this is you imagine that because of the entanglement, the ground state wave function, each boson becomes, so this boson we think of as a particle, we think of each boson as the bound state of two quarks, F1 and F2. You say, well, where are the quarks? The quarks are not real. Well, that's true. In the real world, there's only bosons. But in the many-body wave function of many bosons, they act as if they're both made up of quarks. So this is the exact opposite of what you do in particle physics. Particle physics, you start with the quarks and you build the protons, or the mesons, really. Here we're going to start with the mesons, the theory of mesons, and show you it has a regime where it actually looks at the theory of quarks. And in the process, we'll also get a gauge field. So what we see is that the idea of quarks and fractionalization and gauge fields is kind of an emergent process. It doesn't have to be your fundamental theory. So quite the opposite of the philosophy in particle physics. Yes?
In the first slide, you talked about the CFT3 being...
Ignore that. Sorry, but go on.
So is U1 with one flavor?
Yes.
The next one, how do you perturb the CFT by the other term? So how does CFT change at the fixed point?
I guess you read these slides very quickly. All right, so here's another system of bosons that goes from a superfluid to a valence bond solid, so I don't want to go into this whole story. And there's a CFT here, which is not the XY CFT, it's a different CFT, it's the CP1 model. It's two complex scalars coupled to U1 gauge field. And now you can think of this Bose metal phase as being obtained by applying a chemical potential. So in my recent paper, I took this CFT and added a chemical potential, and I gave kind of plausibility argument that you could, in fact, get a Bose metal in that case. All right, but I don't want to go into that here right now. So I think it's this paper, if you want to know more about that. Okay, but so come back to my main argument. So we start with a system of bosons with some very complicated interactions on a lattice, and what we're going to find emergent are quarks and gauge fields, okay? So from this perspective, whether I think of the system of bosons, the system of bosons as made up of mesons or made up of quarks and gauge fields, just depends upon the particular ground state they happen to be in. So the gauge fields and the quarks are a reflection in this language of the entanglement in the ground state. And that may also be useful perspective for particle physics. Okay, so imagine that each boson is actually made up of two quarks. And then these quarks are just approximately free fermions. So each of these quarks, the number of F1 quarks is equal to the number of bosons. The number of F2 quarks is equal to the number of bosons. And each of the fermions form a Fermi surface, F1 and F2. So right now I'm ignoring the interaction between the fermions. In fact, they're strongly interacting by a gauge field. But the area of this thing, they're going to have a KF. And KF squared, or pi KF squared over 4 pi squared, is equal to the boson density. So if I just do this very simple, naive argument, say each boson splits into two fermions, and the fermions form Fermi surfaces, free Fermi surfaces, then I'd conclude that both of the fermions have obey Luttinger's theorem and have a Fermi wave vector given by the density of bosons. All right, so that's a very radical and absurd thing to say, but it's not absurd, actually. It is true that kind of thing can happen. But of course, thinking of them as free is a bit too strong. They do, these fermions, these quarks, do have strong interactions, and they are described by a gauge theory. So this is a kind of a one-slide summary of how you get the gauge field. So you think of the boson B as made up of the product of two fermion annihilation operators. But now you see from this decomposition that if I change the phase of the fermion 1 by theta and fermion 2 by minus theta, the physical operator, which is the only operator I can measure, which is the gauge, is invariant under this transformation. So any low-energy theory I write down for the F1 and F2 must also respect this transformation. In fact, by writing down different decompositions, in fact, even in this case, I'm sure there's actually a bigger SU2 gauge symmetry here, So you can get not just U1 gauge fields, but you can get Arnoldian gauge fields. And these, we would say, are different types of quantum orders or quantum entanglement in the boson ground state, which particular gauge field is the correct one. In general, it's hard to predict a priori and also quite delicate to measure even in a numerical experiment. Anyway, so if I just take the simplest case of a U1 gauge field, then I'd write down a theory for the F1s and the F2s. And the only way the F1 and the F2s can move, in other words, have a gradient term and respect the symmetry if there's some gauge field there. to make things work out, gauge invariant. So there has to be an emergent gauge field. All right, that's a bit quick, but you can actually start with a lattice model and derive by various Hubbard-Stefanovich transformations, which I introduced in my first lecture, actually derive this kind of effective theory. Yes. I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
I mean, the Fs are, in this case, annihilated.
Yes.
Why do they guess different signs of the experiment?
That's just an arbitrary choice. Well, I have to make them opposite, otherwise B would not be neutral. So whatever sign I choose here, I have to choose the opposite sign, that's all. I have to make sure that B doesn't change. B is gauge neutral. B knows nothing about these emergent quarks. If I, as an experimentalist, I don't see the quarks, I don't see, at least naively, I don't see the gauge field. Of course, it's up to us to actually tell the experimentalist what kind of subtle experiment they have to do to see the quarks. In particle physics, you had the phenomenon of asymptotic freedom, then you allowed you to see the quarks. Here, we usually don't have that, but there are other signals of the quarks, like the entanglement entropy, as I'm going to discuss.
Do you have any interpretation as it's as vortices?
Sorry?
Do you have any simulated interpretation as vortices?
There is a way to interpret them also as vortices in some dual formulation. I think there's a paper by Senthil on that. Yeah. So there's different ways of thinking about it. Anyway, so what you end up with then is something very familiar to particle physicists, is a theory of quarks coupled to gauge fields. And the only thing that's not familiar, at least to most particle physicists, is that the quarks have a Fermi surface. But people doing dense QCD, dense quark matter, have really been talking about Fermi surfaces for many years, although not usually at zero temperature, and also not in two dimensions. And that actually will make a difference. It turns out a Fermi surface coupled to an abelian or a non-abelian gauge field leads to a weakly coupled problem in three spatial dimensions, but a strongly coupled problem in two spatial dimensions, at least at weak gauge coupling. Yeah. You can put it in, but as we'll see in a minute, the most important kinetic term comes from the vacuum polarization correction from the Fermi surface. Just as was the case in my first lecture. In my first lecture, I talked about a very similar theory. So in my very first lecture, I talked about psi bar d slash minus I a slash psi. And then I said there's a term, let's say grad a squared 1 over g. So that's your kinetic term. And then I included the one, the vacuum polarization correction. So integrated out psi. And then I got a term, mod k times a squared. So this comes from the vacuum polarization of the fermions. I did this, schematically did this graph in my first lecture. And then I concluded this term was not important because this has two powers of k and that has only one power of k. Something very similar is going to happen now. So I'm going to just change this thing by just adding a chemical potential and do exactly the same calculation. Yeah?
Here, the fermions, how many degrees of freedom have in the field? One single F, how many degrees?
Well, it's one fermion. Yeah. So this is a choice. You know, I could have written B in terms of 10 fermions if I wanted, and I could have got 10 Fermi surfaces. That's another possibility. There's many, many different decompositions, each of which corresponds to a wholly different type of ground state. So what we're discovering that once you allow yourself this fractionalization possibility, the number of possible ground states is just gigantic, which is good. And a priori, if you give me a boson Hamiltonian, I can't tell you what the answer is going to be. It's a very difficult task to figure out what that answer is, even on a numerical experiment. But each of these decompositions correspond to distinct quantum phases because they have characteristics that can't be smoothly varied, like the number of Fermi surfaces or the entanglement entropy and so on. Yeah.
Is there any obstruction to adding more flavors and making this into some large end?
There is no obstruction. You can do all of that, sure. and yeah, I mean, there's been a whole industry in condensed matter of just having all kinds of stuff. At some point, you get tired of it because there's no evidence for any of it. So we want to just keep life simple right now and work with the simplest case. And once you get to SPT phases, then it's even a bigger zoo. So anyway. all right, so now let me take this state here of a boson. So I postulated with our proof of a finite density state of bosons that's compressible, which doesn't break any symmetries. And I've written down a Lagrangian. And now I'm going to, so that kind of Lagrangian, you wouldn't be surprised, has been again been subject to 20 years of work in condensed matter physics. And I think at this point we have a pretty reasonable understanding of what the answer is, what this kind of Lagrangian describes. And I'm going to summarize and illustrate a few calculations what we know about this kind of theory of what I'll now call a Bose metal. So this is a metal, a strange metal made up of bosons, which decided to fractionalize into quarks. All right, so that's the thing I'm going to fill up. All right, so the first thing is that, as I said, this non-Fermi liquid Bose metal also has a Fermi surface. But now I'm going to call it a hidden Fermi surface, well, hidden in quotes. Just, it's a good word to remember anyway, because just to remind you that I can't possibly do any experiment where I take one of the F2 fermions out of my sample and eject it into the outside world. So there's my sample sitting there of the Bose metal. I send in a photon at slack, and out pops an F1 electron. That's never going to happen. What's going to pop out is a boson, whatever the gauge neutral object is. And that's the photo emission experiment that you do to measure the Fermi surface. You measure the electron distribution function by just the photoelectric effect of Einstein. You send in light, see what comes out, deconvolve everything, you get the whole Fermi surface. So that's a daily bread for many hundreds of experimentalists. You can't do that with the F1s and F2s because they don't exist outside the sample. They can't come out into free space. So that's, in that sense, this is hidden. So if it's hidden, is it there at all? Well, I'm going to argue, yeah, it's there, but you have to tease out its presence in a more careful way. All right, so let's look at what are the excitations of the fermions near this boundary. So for a free Fermi liquid, they just had Z equals 1. And I'm not going to argue that now you have actually very broad excitations, which scale the exponent z equals 3/2. And that's the reason for drawing this hazy coloring, just to tell you there aren't any sharp excitations there. Okay. So the calculation I'm going to do is the exact analog of the calculation that I did in my first lecture for Dirac fermions. So let me just quickly remind you, for Dirac fermions, what I did. When you had Dirac fermions coupled to a gauge field, you integrated out the gauge field, and you found this photon self-energy, which completely dominates the Maxwell term. And then the next step was I looked at the Green's function of the fermions, so psi with one photon, psi. And I found, I think this is okay, right? You can see the board? I think it's, yeah, all right, fine. I'm going to go back and forth. It's going to be a little tricky. If people are okay. If everyone can see, right, I hope. So what I showed you was this thing was, very schematically, was 1 over k slash, and then from this graph, so this will be this plus this, plus all the higher order terms, was plus k slash some log lambda over k. So it was only a log correction, and that told us that there was an anomalous dimension, and we could compute the anomalous dimension in powers of 1 over nf. So there's a 1 over nf over here. That comes from the fact that the gauge field propagator here has a 1 over nf times mod k. So just evaluate this graph. This stuff is all easy because you can just do it. It's relativistically invariant. Okay. All right, so now I'm going to do exactly that after adding a chemical potential. Just exactly the same graphs that particle physicists have been doing in their sleep for 30 years. I'm going to just do the same graphs but add a chemical potential. And as you'll see, that just all hell breaks loose. So first, let's start with this graph. So I'm going to evaluate that graph. Yeah, there it is. But before I even get there, you can write the graph down, and then you can open up Fedor and Valechka and look up the answer. And Fedor and Valechka takes about 10 pages to get at the answer. You look at the answer, it doesn't tell you, you stare at it, and it's a big, messy function. And then you realize solid-state physics is a messy field, and you close the book, and you go off and do other things. And that's, I almost did that early in my life. But let me get the answer using some more elegant formalism. So for that, this is what I'm going to do. So I'm going to focus on, so here's my Fermi surface. This is the F Fermi surface. And let me just focus on one point over here. Ignore the second point for now. So if I focus on this one point here on the Fermi surface, what I see is that the fermion moving in this direction has a linear dispersion. And the fermion moving in that direction, tangent to the Fermi surface, has a quadratic dispersion. So at low energies, I can write down this fermion psi plus. Again, ignore psi minus. It won't be important for my discussion here. I'll have a d by dx of a fermion moving in this direction and a d by dy squared for a fermion moving tangent to the Fermi surface. And if I was in higher dimensions, I'd have d minus 1 directions along y. They'll all have quadratic dispersion. So one linearly dispersing direction and d minus 1 quadratically dispersing directions. So that tells me my fermion Green's function, first of all, psi Green's function, psi, is equal to 1 over, and I'm going to work in imaginary time. This is minus I omega minus k minus ky squared over 2. I don't even have the 2 there. Okay. So that's the dispersion of my fermion. So I have to take this dispersion now and put it into this graph. So that's what I do over here. So that's the graph I'm evaluating. This is the photon self-energy. That's I omega plus k plus ky squared. So I think one of these signs is wrong. There has to be the same sign over here and there. And this is, I have sent in, I have to now differentiate momentum and frequency. I send in momentum and frequency here, and there it is. So this is the kind of integral I have to evaluate. This should be minus signs here, because it's really a small q. Sorry about that. Okay, so this is the integral I have to evaluate. Now, this integral is ultraviolet divergent. So that's the point where, as particle theorists get worried because, it doesn't make any sense. The UV behavior is not well-defined, so you have to renormalize, and all these other scary thoughts come to your mind. But really, here I don't care. What I'm really interested in the low-frequency behavior. There's always some cutoff at high frequency and high momenta. So in fact, I just ignore the ultraviolet divergence. I'm just going to look at the low-frequency behavior. And in particular for that, it turns out to be useful to interchange the order of integration. So the first thing I do, and so this is a detail of actually how you do the integrals. The first thing you do is you do integral over kx. You can see kx appears linearly here, and kx appears linearly over here. So that integral is easy to do. It's just by a contour integral. You just pick up, close the contour in the upper or the lower half plane. And when the whole thing is thus settled, you get the integrals over ky along d minus 1 directions, and still the integral over frequency. And then here you get the sum of the residues. And this just ensures that the poles are in opposite half planes. So that's actually the key thing here. You see here, and that's why the sign is important, actually, it should be minus. If this was a minus sign, and the sign of this was the same as the sign of this, this integral is just zero. because I can close the contour in the upper half plane. So the sine of this frequency has to be opposite of the sine of that frequency. And then the poles are on the opposite half planes. And so then I can call the integral. And so that's why you get this strange sine function in the numerator. And then you get the sum of the residues in the denominator. Okay, now you notice the denominator has no dependence on the loop frequency epsilon. And so you can do this integral. And that integral, that's one of the key factors, gives you this mod omega. Okay, and finally you do the integral over the transverse directions. And now this is an easy integral to do. It's ultraviolet divergent, so you put in some phase factor here. But the most important factor when you do this integral is you pick up this factor of mod qy, which is the momentum of the photon transversed to the Fermi surface. Okay. And that result isn't Fedor and Valechka, but, you know, after, believe me, much messier calculations. So what we have found then is if you have a Fermi surface here, and you have a photon coming in, and this is the x direction, and this is the y direction, and you have a photon at very low momentum, the self-energy of the photon, sigma a, as a function of qx, qy, and omega, so qx and qy for the photon are measured at the origin, for the fermion they're measured from here, turns out to be equal to mod omega over qy. So this is a famous factor, sometimes called the Landau damping factor. It's the fact that it's mod omega means that this is dissipative. So when I go to real frequencies, this becomes I omega. So the photon is damped. It damps by emitting particle hole pairs. The photon can come in. It's damped because there's all these electrons in, sitting there inside the Fermi surface. You know, the ordinary electron through the vacuum polarization, it has to create an electron-positron pair which costs energy 2mc squared. So for frequencies below 2mc squared, the photon has no problem. It's still, nothing happens to it. Charge gets renormalized and that's it. It's like, so the vacuum of our world is like an insulator with an energy gap of 2mc squared. And the photon is transparent in this insulator. So photons can get right through vacuum. Here we're talking about a photon in a system that doesn't have a gap. And the vacuum polarization, and it immediately starts, it decays very quickly, it doesn't propagate at all, just immediately absorbed. And this is, if you wish, some measure of the absorption cross section of the photon. And it diverges at small q. Okay. All right, so that's the most important difference then between zero chemical potential and finite chemical potential is the presence of Landau damping. So then, this term here is not mod k anymore. It's equal to plus mod omega over qy times nf times a squared. And at this point here, you know, we can't immediately throw this whole thing out. We have to be a little bit careful. It turns out, well, you can certainly throw out the frequency dependence, but the bare terms, the ones that are important, are basically the qy squared term here plus the qx squared, but that's not going to play much of a role. The omega squared term you can throw out because it's always much smaller than the mod omega. So that's the very strange-looking photon propagator we have. It's q squared plus mod omega over q. Okay. I know that's just, it's so scary and so unusual, but that's life, okay? So a photon propagator, where did it go? Is, let me write it down here. This is the photon propagator, it's q squared plus mod omega over q. All right, so next, let's evaluate this graph. Now, what does this do to the fermion? Let's go back one more step and figure out what it does to the fermions. So now you have the electron propagator, which is right here. You have the photon propagator, which is right here. So I'm doing exactly the same calculation that in a CFT gave me anomalous dimension. But here, it's going to be not as simple. In fact, we have a much stronger effect. Okay, so now you have to do the same integral, and if you really want to see how it's done, well, there's the steps. You again, it's the same thing. You do the kx integral first, and then the frequency integral, and when the dust settles, you get this result with an omega to the 2/3. So now what have we found for the fermion self-energy? The fermion propagator, after I include the self-energy, turns out to be I. Oh, well, although this is in, well, okay, this is an imaginary frequency, so let's stay in imaginary frequency, is omega to the 2/3. And it's roughly independent of momentum. So, what does this mean? Well, if I now look at the electron spectral function, so now I go to real frequencies. This is in imaginary frequencies. So if I analytically continue this thing, this becomes 1 over omega minus kx minus ky squared plus some e to the 2 pi I, e to the pi I over 3, which is some complex number, times omega to the 2/3. So if I plot now imaginary part of g of k and omega as a function of omega for some k and omega, previously when I had this term, I would get a pole when omega equals kx plus ky squared. But now I don't have any pole because this thing is always non-zero. And so I get something like that. Some continuum of excitations which have the property that the imaginary part. So if I compare this with this, you see that roughly the scale of this maximum will be omega is approximately k to the 3/2. So that's the main result I wanted to get, that there's some diffuse excitations near the Fermi surface where omega goes as k to the 3/2. Okay, so now I can, I'll come back to that in a minute. So I can, that's the reason for this next term here. So in the Fermi liquid, I had sharp excitations with z equals 1. I have diffuse excitations with z equals 3/2. So now this particular result, we've looked at up to 3 loops. This is just a very simple calculation at 1 loop. And so far, we found no corrections. It may well be an exact result. We don't know yet, but anyway, it's 3/2. And I'll give you some further evidence from holography with that actually that 3/2 may well be exact. We'll see. All right, so now, okay, before I get there, let me give you another argument. So I told you right now, if you want to get 3/2, you have no, you know, all you have to do is evaluate these horrible graphs. So, okay, but obviously no one wants to evaluate horrible graphs. So now let me give you another argument where you can get the 3/2 just by staring at a piece of paper. Okay, so this was my original theory. Again, ignore the psi minus. Just take the psi plus and the gauge field. And this is the minimal coupling of a photon, which is actually polarized transverse to this direction, so photon points in the y direction. You choose a gauge, or the Landau gauge of the photon is only in the y direction. All right, so, the photon's in the x direction, but it depends on qy. Right, it's transverse. So what we've learned from this horrible calculation is that the self-energy term in the photon is much more important than this term at small frequencies. So let me just use that piece of information. So let me say that's what that's going to happen. I'm going to get a non-Fermi liquid. That's really why this thing had a branch cut rather than the pole, because this term was negligible compared to the induced term from the photon. So let me just throw out the time derivative. That d by d tau is what gave me the omega here. Now I have a theory here, and I'm going to just look at its scale invariance properties. So this theory is invariant under scale transformations. So let's try to put them in. Oops, what am I doing? Okay. Oh, shit. It's too large. Anyway, I'm going to have to bring that down. Okay. All right, so, yikes. All right, so what do I do? Well, let me try. So I'm going to rescale x by x over s, and y by, well, if I want to make the whole thing invariant, I better scale x and y with twice the exponent for this thing to remain invariant. So y over s squared, and tau time, I'm going to scale as tau over s to the z. So I make this scale transformation. Now the leading term in here is dx, dy, d tau, say psi dagger, psi dagger, the d by d tau is gone because it's irrelevant. So I have I d by dx, another term, psi. So if I want to make this term invariant under these transformations, I see the x will cancel with that x. The y will give me a factor of 2, and this will give me a factor of z. And so the dimension of psi will be, it'll be 2 plus z over 2. So if I, in other words, if I scale psi by psi of s to the 2 plus z over 2, then this whole thing will remain the same. And you do that with every term, and just demand that everything remain invariant. So that's a very powerful type of scaling argument that condensed metaphysicists use all the time. All right, so if you do that, all right, did I get that right? Well, luckily I can't check because it's erased. So I didn't do it right. It seems like, why didn't I do it right? I don't know. 2z plus 1 over, so z, the s to the 1 over 4. Oh, I had the wrong way. So y has to be s to the 1 half. I'm sorry, not s squared. There we go. So that, I had this inverted. That's okay, anyway. So if you do that, you get psi goes this way. Now A, the gauge field, has to scale as d by dx, so it has to have dimension 1, otherwise that's gauge invariance. And so then there's finally G. So G scales like this. So now you have a kind of a strange feature here. G is a coupling constant. It determines the strength of interactions. Just by rescaling A, I can move G over here. But I still have the freedom. I haven't fixed z at all. Z could be anything, and this whole thing is scale invariant, provided I scale g. And the reason I haven't fixed z is because I don't have any time derivative terms that I usually use to fix z. So now let me assume it's the interactions that are going to fix z. The interactions are much more important than the bare term. That's what we found from the perturbative argument. And this means, so if I want to go to some fixed point scale invariant theory, G should be scale invariant. And since I have the freedom to choose Z, let me make it scale invariant, and I get Z equals 3 halves. So that's a very slick but actually correct argument, which allows you to not evaluate those Feynman graphs. Okay, so you get Z equals 3 halves. And then through similar arguments, you'll find that, in fact, the entropy density goes as T to the 1 over Z. And finally, you find also from various studies of various people, the entanglement entropy does have a signature of the Fermi surface in exactly the same way as for a Fermi liquid. The reference here is these people here. Particularly, there's a numerical work of Zhang et al., which did find exactly this kind of P log P dependence of the entanglement entropy. All right, so that's then the end of my condensed matter hat. I argued, and I think at this point the evidence is quite strong, that it's possible for there to be other compressible phases other than the ones described by Fermi liquid, which don't break any symmetries. And these compressible phases, the simplest mental picture I have of them, it's made up of some new emergent fermions, which form Fermi surfaces. And these interact with each other with all masses of gauge field. That's really the bottom line. And the area of the Fermi surface of the fermion is still constrained by some kind of counting argument. It can't be anywhere you want. It's constrained by the density of your particles. And that Fermi surface shows up. It's hidden. It can't be detected by a photoemission experiment, but it can be detected in the entanglement entropy. Even the entropy you can think of as its magnitude is measuring the existence of the Fermi surface. It can be measured in something called Friedel oscillations, which are scattering of the fermions across the diameter of a Fermi surface, and various other more subtle probes, but not the most obvious probe, which is why we call it a hidden Fermi surface. And at least for bosons on the lattice, there's pretty good evidence for certain spin systems that this kind of phase does indeed exist. Although it's not proof, yeah.
Can you realize C to the D half from the CFT that you presented in CT1 model?
Well, yeah, I'd have to go through this argument right here. This is the argument. Also, there's all these phases, as you see, even though there's many possibilities, there's still some very strong restrictions. I mean, these all of the phases I mentioned, that you can have any number of Fermi surfaces, you can have abelian gauge field, non-abelian gauge fields, whatever you want, these are all common properties. This doesn't seem to be any way to avoid any of them. As far as we know today, we could be wrong, but this is our current understanding. Yeah.
Forget the scaling argument for
R. Yes. Oh, it certainly is. It is. Oh, absolutely. Well, I mean, it's the gauge coupling. You're keeping the gauge coupling fixed. Let's move the G over there by rescaling the gauge field. So the gauge G is the gauge coupling, and we're demanding that the gauge coupling be fixed. So sort of like a nonlinear sigma model defined on the superspace of fermions and the gauge field, it's like a Yukawa coupling. So we are doing a renormalization, not at fixed kinetic energy, which is the way we've been taught to do it. We're doing a renormalization at fixed nonlinear coupling. So it's more in the spirit of a nonlinear sigma model. That's one way to understand this strange Z equals 3/2. Okay, so now I'm going to show you that in some sense the Z equals 3/2 also emerges from a holographic argument. It's kind of this is following some very beautiful paper by Tadashi and Ogawa, that the Z equals 3/2 really is something very special. We've seen it's very special here in field theory, and it turns out to be very special also in holography. All right, so now holography in the last half hour. Okay, so this is my understanding of holography. So since we have all these exponents, z and theta, so now I'm going to try to think about holography also in terms of scaling arguments. So imagine I do have some kind of compressible non-Fermi liquid sitting in my bulk, sitting in my boundary, and I want a holographic description of it. And I don't know how to do it, but let me assume that it actually reproduces some of these properties, this list of properties I made here. So it has to have let's keep z arbitrary, and it has to, and also have theta. Let me just define theta to be, where's my pointer? You can view this as the definition of theta. Theta is whatever you need here to get the entropy right. Okay. So that's my definition of Z. It's the scaling of how energy scales with momentum, gives me Z. And theta tells me how entropy goes with temperature. Forget about the word hyperscaling. So that kind of thing is called hyperscaling in condensed matter physics for obscure historical reasons. All right, so now I'll show you in the next 5 minutes or so that definition of theta is equivalent to this definition of theta. So imagine I have some bulk metric, ds squared, is, you know, some function of dx squared, dy squared, d tau squared, and dr squared. Actually, let me just make this. This is x, the vector. This is d-dimensional. All right. So I'm going to want this metric to be such that under the after I do rescaling transformation, so I rescale x, so call x goes to zeta times x, and t goes, so this is x vector, goes to zeta to the z times t. And the full distance, the proper distance ds, now normally, if you remember, when you, people have done these kind of scaling arguments by a particular Kakru et al. When they talked about Lipschitz scaling, they implicitly assumed that ds goes to ds. But that's actually not the most general possibility. And now we have many holographic models where this is not true. So let's allow this also to pick up a factor. And I'm going to call that theta over d. And the reason I'm calling that theta over d is just to, as we'll see, is anticipating that this definition of theta will coincide with the old definition of theta from the entropy. Okay. All right, if someone gave you this, you can basically reconstruct the whole metric. And the answer is here. It's this metric. And the reason is, well, you know, you just demand this thing be invariant. It's just a one page of algebra. And you also have some reparameterization invariance. And you choose a reparameterization invariance to fix how R transforms. And it's just a convenient choice to make R transform this way. You can make R transform any way you want, just by calling R squared is my new R. So the holographic distance is up to you. You can take it any power of R you want. So we just choose R to transform this way, and then this is the solution of this equation. Okay, so I urge you to just go through the algebra. I can never remember those terms, so anyway, that's all there is. So this is some metric. And we know now today, or in fact, there were metrics in the literature before, which are of this form, for some values of theta and z. Okay, so now what I want to show you, just given this metric and nothing else, you can figure out the temperature dependence of the entropy, and you can also figure out the entanglement entropy without really any more information. So let's do the first. So let me take this metric. So this is a scale invariant metric. It's scale invariant because it's a scale covariant, shall I say, because under scale transformation, the proper distance just gets multiplied by a factor. It's not invariant, it's covariant. All right, so now let's raise it to finite temperature. Now, in general, when I raise it to finite temperature, you'll say, well, no, I got to resolve my Einstein's equations at finite temperature, put in a horizon, I get horrible functions, a Schwarzschild metric, and which becomes even more complicated in general. But if you're just interested in low temperature behavior, you don't need to do any of that. You just proceed by the power of the scaling argument. So what you know for sure is that there's going to be a horizon. And let's say it's at position R sub h. Let it be there, okay? So what is the entropy? Well, the entropy is the area of the horizon, as Bekenstein and Hawking taught us. Really, we're talking about the density here, area per unit volume of the boundary system. So what is the area here? Well, let's go back to my metric. My metric here, have I got this right? Something's fishy. Okay. Oh, no, it's fine. So I have to measure the area in this direction. So I have to do the integral over dx. Okay, that's the x direction. So if I look at my metric, in the dx direction, it's 1 over r squared. And in fact, that's why I made this rather peculiar choice. I made this peculiar choice to make sure that what was multiplying dx squared was exactly 1 over r squared. So for each factor of x, I get a factor of 1 over r. So the area of the horizon is 1 over rh to the d, basically. So that's my answer. If I knew rh for this metric, if I knew where the horizon was, then the entropy would be rh to the minus d. That's the Bekenstein-Hawking result. So where is rh? Well, this is where the scaling arguments come in. What we've learned from the scaling argument is that just by changing coordinates, you can move the r anywhere you want to be. So you can always do a rescaling to put rh equals 1. And that will then tell us what this value is, provided we know how the area scales under the transformation. So here's basically the argument. So if I pick a factor zeta, let's see if I can get this right. So from this, for example, I know that temperature that goes as inverse this, goes as zeta to the minus z times temperature. Because temperature is always inverse time. It's the circumference of the horizon in the time direction. Okay, so let's call this equal and call this t tilde. So I have one coordinate system where I have temperature t, another coordinate system where I have temperature t tilde. So I have a physical temperature t. Now let me choose my zeta such that t tilde equals 1. So if t tilde is equal to 1, that implies zeta is equal to t to the 1 minus 1 over z. Minus 1 over z. Okay. So what I conclude is that if I choose my rescaling factor zeta to be temperature to the minus 1 over z, I'll end up with a new system with temperature as 1. So if it's 1, I don't care about it. It's just a constant somewhere in my theory. Now let me do the same rescaling to the RH. So in my new system, what is the new value of RH? So my RH will be zeta to the power of d minus theta over d times R tilde H. And I know what zeta is. And therefore, I conclude that R tilde H is temperature, or RH is really temperature to the power, basically d minus theta over z minus times RH tilde. Right. Anyway, so, and then you use the fact that S is RH tilde to the minus d in the new scale, and all tildes are of order 1, so you don't care about them. And you conclude that the entropy is power t to the d minus t theta over z. Okay, that's the kind of argument that many critical phenomena books are chocked full of. It's called a scaling argument, and I'm sure it can be done a little more cleanly than that. But anyway, you stare at it and you figure it out for yourself. So, and of course, I assure you, we did the hard work of actually solving the metric in many cases, and this certainly works. So I conclude the entropy density is T to the d minus theta over z, and that was secretly my reason for putting this equal to theta over d, because I wanted to come out the way it's normally written in critical phenomena. So this tells me what the meaning of this theta is in this way of thinking about things. Theta, so if I had a conformal field theory with this thing would be t to the d. So this tells me that a system with a non-zero theta sort of looks like a system in a lower dimension, which is d effective, which is d minus theta, at least when theta is positive. And that's what a Fermi surface is. You know, a Fermi surface, as I've said many times, for many aspects, a system with a Fermi surface looks like it's one-dimensional, effectively locally one-dimensional. And so that's why for a Fermi surface, theta is d minus 1. All right, yeah, so I guess I've already said that. Okay, so if this metric is going to look like any compressible state that I know in condensed matter, theta should be d minus 1. Okay, so now I go ahead and given a metric, there's one more thing I can do without any further work. Well, it takes some work, but there's another thing I can do just working with the metric, and that's compute the entanglement entropy. So now we like the value theta equals d minus 1 because it gives us the right entropy. Let's see what it does for the entanglement entropy. Okay, before I get there. Before I even get there. So this is a metric, which is a solution of some Einstein's equation. Okay, so once I know the metric, I can, from Einstein's equation, tell me g mu nu equals t mu nu. So if you know the metric, you know t mu nu. There's something called the null energy condition, which is some constraint on t mu nu. But t mu nu is greater than 0 or something like that. Somebody says, excuse me, I forgot. So there's a null energy condition that applies to this thing. So you take that metric, compute its Einstein tensor, that's equal to t mu nu, and you apply the null energy condition to t mu nu. Okay. So I actually did that. It was my first time I actually computed the Einstein tensor in my life. And you find it's satisfied provided this is true. So you get this very interesting looking bound. Z has to be greater than or equal to theta over d. So now let's put d equals 2, which is the case I'm interested in. And I've argued from the entropy that theta should be 1. Theta should be d minus 1 to get the right entropy. And I get the result z is greater than or equal to 3 halves. So this is sort of like a religious experience for me. this sort of argument was first made by a somewhat different argument in this paper by Tadashi and collaborators. To see the z equals 3 halves appear as special is really amazing. There's a completely different argument using gravity as opposed to all these Fermi surfaces. Okay, but it's a lower bound anyway, and is there some reason z should stick to the lower bound? Well, I don't really know. There's some speculation in a paper by, what's his name, Sean, the graduate student at Stanford. Shagulian, right, that there's something special about z equals 3 half holographically. I don't fully understand that. Okay, so finally, as I was saying, you can go ahead and compute the entanglement entropy. So put theta equals d minus 1 and compute the entanglement entropy. And amazingly, for this without, now we know everything. We know theta and z, we have an inequality. You get p log p. Exactly as you wanted for a Fermi, any kind of non-Fermi liquid or Fermi liquid. And here's kind of the argument, so if you want to see how much I'm doing on time, it's only 10 minutes. Okay, so this is how it works. You take some entangling region, surface area sigma, and this is the holographic direction, and I choose some coordinates. So the equation of this curve is xd equals w of xj, which is d minus 1 directions. And you also represent the minimal surface. This is going to be a minimal surface. XD is some function of R and XJ. So I'm going to use R and X as my independent variables and XD as my dependent variable. Often you want to, what seems intuitively the simpler thing to do is to take XG and XD as the independent variable and R as the dependent variable. But it turns out to be simpler to think about it the other way. So you write the area of this surface. In some coordinate system, that's what it looks like. And then you try to evaluate this integral. And the key thing then is really depends upon what happens to the surface. And the notes are all here. What happened to the surface at small r? So at r equals 0, if I go back here, at r equals 0, this is what the surface looks like. But at non-zero r, it's something else, capital W. So r is small. So let's imagine it starts with some power of r, r to the n, times some function sigma. Now, it turns out you can use the minimal surface criterion to fix the value of n. So I won't go through the details, just a bit of algebra. What you find that n is equal to 2d. So d equals 2 is 4. So this tells me that this surface actually comes in really very almost vertically with a fourth power. It doesn't look like this at all. It comes in with a fourth power. It's almost flat here. And that's actually very useful. That's the key property of the surface. Any minimal surface has the property that this is 2D. And from that, then you can say a lot of things. And then you can minimize the area. And what you find is that when theta is d minus 1, it's just given by p log p and so on and so forth. I guess in a lot of time. And also, not only is it p log p, but it's shape independent. You can figure out that the area of this surface, the minimal surface, when theta is d minus 1, doesn't depend on the shape of the surface, which is kind of surprising, but it's true. So you can show that once you get that n is equal to 4. That's crucial in establishing the shape independence. Anyway, so that's exactly that's a highly non-trivial property of a Fermi liquid or a Fermi surface, that its entanglement entropy is shape independent, and that also comes out. Okay. All right, so I'm just going to. So there are actual solutions by some of these. Rene is here, so you can ask him more about this. I guess he had the first solution of this type in some dilaton models. And if you form the actual solutions, furthermore, you can also look at the coefficient here. And the coefficient also turns out to work out right. In other words, it's proportional to kf to the d minus 1. That also comes out. Okay, so this is a summary then what I've said so far. So there is a possibility in some holographic model to get something that's pretty close to the kind of compressible phases we already know in condensed matter. That doesn't mean there aren't and more compressible phases, but anyway, it's nice that there's at least two sets of solutions on the two sides that seem to really converge onto each other. In this way of presenting, in the holographic side, at this moment, there's one free parameter. This is a choice. You do a fine-tuning, for which I have no reason at the moment. I fine-tune my holographic model to have theta equals d minus 1. Once I fix theta that way, with that one piece of fine-tuning, about 6 different things come out correct. Log violation of entanglement entropy, the shape independence, the lower bound for z, being equal to the actual value, average of the prefactor coming out right. And this is something I haven't talked about, a couple of papers on this where shown that if you actually want to see the Fermi wave vector more directly, then monopole operators are likely to play a crucial role in this. So I'm just going to skip that. All right, so in the last 5 minutes, I'm going to talk about some more recent work, just to advertise. Conformal field theory and periodic chemical potential. This is with Andy Lucas. Andy's right here. So here we're looking at kind of an intermediate case. So my first two lectures were a conformal field theory in zero chemical potential. My lecture today was a conformal field theory in non-zero chemical potential. Now we look at a conformal field theory in a zero average chemical potential, but which has a periodic variation. So we actually, for many calculations, we took a cosine wave, but for some, it's easier to think in terms of a square wave. So suppose I had this chemical potential. And knowing me, you know the first thing I do when I meet a problem is solve it with free Dirac fermions. So that turned out to be amazingly rich over here. So suppose I take this potential and solve it for free Dirac fermions. Okay. What do you get? So that, and does holography reproduce it? That's another question you can ask. You were motivated, of course, by all the work that Sean and David Tong and Gary Horowitz and George Santos have been doing on the effect of the periodic potential. But we said, well, let's just look at the simplest case where the average of the chemical potential is zero. And the reason is that you can make rather general arguments in that case that deep in the IR, a system is again a conformal field theory. So that's life. That makes life simple because you know deep in the IR, you got to get the ADS-4 metric. And that we certainly find from our studies. Okay, so here's how you might think of it, if you were a condensed matter theorist. You would say, well, here, let's imagine this K is very small. So these are huge regions. Then locally, if I'm sitting here, I have a positive chemical potential. And well, with the sign of, then it depletes, so I have a whole Fermi surface. And in here, I have an electron Fermi surface and a hole and an electron. But of course, that's not the whole story, because that's kind of the like the local density approximation. If I was doing a fluid approximation, that's what I'd say. But there's something more going on here. We can, in this case, I can solve the whole thing. I'd say, you know, this region tunnels into this region, it tunnels into that region. I have to solve the whole thing. And this is where Bloch's theorem comes in. There's a Bloch theorem, and you can find the band structure. All right, so that's standard solid-state physics. If you work out the band structure, this is sort of how things look. So the first thing you notice from Bloch's theorem is this wavelength is 2 pi over k. That means that the momenta along the x direction are defined only modulo k. So k for qx in the x direction is the same as qx plus k. So I'm going to take qx only from minus k over 2 to minus k over 2, and you're going to get many bands. So when v over k is small, this is the kind of dispersion you get. You see the Dirac fermion that was present, and the potential is just a weak perturbation. But when you add, when you turn up v over k, make it larger and larger, you find you get secondary minima along the y direction. And in fact, although you can't see it in this picture, there's another Dirac point there and there's a Dirac point here. So this is a rather remarkable phenomenon, which has been known in the graphene literature, is that when you put graphene in a periodic potential, then it develops multiple Dirac nodes. Starts out with, well, 4, and then here you get 3 times 4, 12, and so on. Here's how you can understand it in a 2-minute argument. So let's start with the original system, which is this system here with the Fermi surface. So that Fermi surface is this dashed line. And goes from minus V to V, where V is the amplitude of the potential. Okay, that's because V is the local chemical potential. Now, I told you Q is only defined modulo K. So Q is only meaningful inside this region, from minus K over 2 to K over 2. So let me take that Fermi surface and fold it back in. That's what this blue line is. It's the folded Fermi surface. And what you find is where these folded Fermi surfaces intersect, you get new Dirac points. So these black circles are where they're Dirac points. So it's just really undergraduate quantum mechanics to solve a scattering problem and find those Dirac points. So you have this rather remarkable result then. So for this free CFT, and also in the large NF limit, for large but finite NF, you have the following result. When you take a CFT, and you put it in a periodic chemical potential, in the IR, it's still a CFT, but in general, it's a different CFT. It's a different CFT because the number of Dirac fermions, the flavor number is changing. You start out with a CFT with 4 fermions, and you end up with a CFT with any number you want, 4, 8, 12, a million. It depends on the value of V over K. Now, some of you may find this is very strange because it totally violates any C theorem. C theorem says that the number of degrees of freedom should be smaller in the IR than in the UV. Whereas here's a simple example where that's simply not true. And that's because this system is non-relativistic invariant. So there is no C theorem for non-relativistic systems. And so this is a system which is relativistic both in the UV and the IR, not in between, and the IR C is much, much larger than the UVC. Okay. All right, so anyway, so let me just finish by a few plots. So that's the physics from the Dirac fermion point of view. There's corresponding physics from the holographic point of view. It involves some perturbation theory computation of Witten diagrams that Andy did, and some numerical solution of Einstein's partial differential equations that Andy and Paul worked on. And from all of that, we get some results for the conductivity, which is the quantity I've been talking about a lot. So for small v over k, so this is the region where I have this region, I have only one Dirac fermion. In that case, you know, in this picture, K and V are, well, K, this dashed line is actually outside V. So then there's no problem, just there's only one direct from here. So in that case, for small v, this is the free direct fermion result. This is the holographic result. And they're not bad. You know, again, it's very similar to the correspondence between graphene and the Reisner-Nordström black hole. It seems to work here also. And at large v over k, again, it's not too bad. In holography, you get a big peak at omega of order k, and it saturates to a constant. And that's roughly what you get. Some depends on the value of precise value of v. This is a kind of interband transition. But there's a big peak at omega of order k, and it again saturates to a constant, both at small frequency and large frequency. So all of that looks good. But now let me take the DC conductivity value, that value there, and plot it as a function of v over k. And this is what you get. And they're totally different. So in the large NF field theory calculation, you get these big peaks. And these peaks are the signs at the position and with the CFT changes. So you get a CFT with one direct fermion, three direct fermions, five direct fermion. The positions where the direct points split are these peaks. But if you look, if you kind of say, okay, these peaks are, you know, a weak interaction effect, and maybe they just get washed out. Well, if they get washed out, yeah, well, that's what holography does, it washes them out. So that's the bottom line, is that holography, yeah, which is consistent with the kind of thing Sean said, just washes out the Fermi surface. So here we try to get rid of the Fermi surface by putting an average zero chemical potential. Well, what we find is to all orders on 1 over NF, you don't actually get rid of it. It still has ghosts in these new direct points. And they're, of course, very sharp at NF equals infinity, and presumably they become broader, but they're still there. So these oscillatory features, then, I view as a signal of the Fermi surface, sort of like Friedel's. So these oscillations are missing. And I think that's one of the major challenges for future work, is to get these kind of oscillatory features back in from holography. So thank you. Experimental status. I think the best candidates are these triangular lattice antiferromagnets of organic compounds. There's this, it has a, okay, ETME3PDDMI2. So it's a very complicated molecule. Kanoda's group in Tokyo has been studying these triangular lattice antiferromagnets. So these are insulators, but they're Bose metals in the spin sector. So if you look at the spin susceptibility, that's finite at low temperatures, and that's the analog of the statement that it's a compressible system because the spin susceptibility is finite, and the conserved quantity there is spin, not charge. And the specific heat and the thermal conductivity have very suggestive behavior of some kind of non-Fermi liquid. So that's probably the best candidate that people are most excited about right now. It's these triangular lattice antiferromagnets in. I forget the compound, but it's PDDMIT2 something. It's some horrible organic compound. In fact, that's pretty much the only compound. It's just one compound. It's a little scary to base everything on one compound, but hopefully there'll be other examples. You know, what really happens, as I said, with bosons or spins, you take your system and you work on it really hard, and you find in the lab that it either Bose condenses, which in the spin system means you get magnetic order, or it becomes an insulator, which is something like a valence bond solid or something. So all of those are seen much more commonly. But to get a compressible phase, yeah, it's hard. There's numerical studies on ladders with increasing width that suggest that they do exist. And also from all the theoretical work, it's a good possibility these things are there, but they're very hard to find. Is this kind of state, Bose metal state, somehow related to the high temperature superconductors, the strange metal region in the high temperature superconductors that everybody shows? I think there are people in the community who believe that. I think Matthew Fisher had a paper recently kind of suggesting that, and certainly Senthil has talked about it. With me personally, actually, I don't believe it. I think there's a lot of evidence against it in the high-temperature superconductors.